Not everybody needs a reason to kill, but some people have discovered disturbing or dark motivations to end the lives of others. Today we present to you the top 10 bizarre murder motives. Number 10. Burned Yurtigan. Usually when we die, we are all supposed to be left to rot. Unless you're the victim of Armin Maywis, then you may end up in his fry pan. Armin Maywis was convicted for the murder of burned Yurtigan Armando Brandes on March 9th, 2001, though the circumstances are far stranger. According to Armin, he wished to eat human flesh and thus posted a request in a website named The Cannibal Cafe. Armin posted that he was looking for a young man to eat. Burned volunteered. After killing Burned, Armin consumed at least 20 kilograms of Burned's body before being arrested. Officers also discovered that Armin even had a tape in which he filmed the death of Burned with the approval of Burned, and later declared that he did all of it out of sexual pleasure. Today, Armin is a vegetarian and has aided the German police in 2 cases of cannibalism. He also estimates that today there are around 800 cannibals in Germany. Number 9. William Burke and William Hare. During the 19th century, the Scottish city of Edinburgh was at the forefront of medical anatomy research, and the need for fresh corpses for dissection was in high demand. Lodging house owners William Burke and William Hare discovered how highly profitable this practice was after one of Hare's tenants died before paying. Burke and Hare sold the corpse to Dr. Knox, a well-known anatomist, and got handsomely paid for it. After such a successful and profitable experience, Burke and Hare decided that selling bodies to science would be a good source of income. From January to October of 1828, Burke and Hare lured people into their houses and killed them by suffocation after they had driven them drunk. After that, they took them to Surgeon Square to sell the corpses. In total, they sold 16 corpses to Dr. Knox. After being captured, Hare accepted immunity in exchange for testifying against Burke. After a horrible confusion of all the murders, William Burke was executed by hanging on January 28, 1829. Burke's body was later dissected, and his skeleton is currently exhibited in the Anatomical Museum of Edinburgh Medical School. Number 8. Good luck albinos killed. Albinism is a condition that can make your life slightly difficult as you are born without any pigment in your hair, eyes, or skin, and can lead to several health problems, including eyesight problems and higher chances of skin cancer, which can shorten your lifespan. Though, if you live in sub-Saharan Africa, being albino is a death sentence from day one. There is a very ancient tradition about albinos in sub-Saharan Africa, which has led to persecution and killings. In countries such as Tanzania and Malawi, albinos are persecuted due to the belief that their body parts can be used in rituals and potions that will bring good luck to those who consume them. No one is safe from these rituals, as children are the main target of this practice, since they are easier to handle and dismember. Justice can be slow, as this tradition is so deeply engraved in society and highly profitable that even the police are involved. Number 7. Dennis Nilsson. Born on November 23, 1945, Dennis Nilsson was a seemingly normal, gay, lonely man with necrophilic fantasies and an urge for company. After being unable to get company through normal methods, Dennis went for more unorthodox ways. On December 30, 1978, Nilsson encountered a 14-year-old named Stephen Holmes. Both drank heavily and spent the night in Nilsson's apartment. The next morning, Nilsson decided he wanted the company of Stephen, whether Stephen wanted it or not, and thus strangulated him. Dennis kept Stephen's corpse for 8 months before burning it. During that time, he masturbated over Holmes's body and washed it with unusual care. After the killing of Holmes, Dennis began a spree of 11 other victims until 1983, when he was arrested. All said victims were led with the promise of a good night of food and alcohol, strangled and/or drowned, and then carefully washed and dressed. Nilsson used them to provide himself with company on his lonely nights and to satisfy his necrophilic fetish. This habit gained Nilsson the nickname of the Kindly Killer. Number 6. George Spencer. Born in 1600, George Spencer was a non-believer who immigrated to the New Haven colony in what's today the state of Connecticut in the United States. George Spencer was well known for his ugliness, his glass eye, his baldness, as well as his mischievous habits. Before arriving to the colony, Spencer lived in Boston and was flogged after he was declared guilty of receiving stolen goods. In New Haven, he had a poor reputation due to his open lack of faith and his ungraceful appearance, which made rumors circulate among the people of New Haven. New Heaven about allegedly perverted acts Spencer committed daily. Though nothing could ever be proved, Spencer's life gave a turn for the worst when a pig gave birth to a piglet with one eye. At the sight of the newborn pig, the people of New Heaven went into an uproar, believing the piglet was born out of an act of sodomy and bestiality committed by Spencer. During the trial, Spencer pled guilty in hope of a lesser sentence, but Spencer's decision backfired, as his statement was used to declare him guilty and condemned to death by hanging on April 8, 1642. Spencer was the first non-Native American executed in Connecticut. Number 5. Morgan Gaiser and Anissa Weyer. Morgan Gaiser and Anissa Weyer are two 14-year-old girls from Waukesha, Wisconsin that, on May 31, 2014, stabbed Peyton Lautner in an attempt to impress the fictional character known as Slender Man and become their proxies. Morgan and Anissa were 12 at the time of their assassination attempt. They had become obsessed with the creepypasta known as Slender Man, a tall, featureless man who is said to live in forests, stalk children, and is said to drive those who are close to him to insanity. Morgan and Anissa became convinced that the Slender Man was real, and if they killed someone, the girls would live with him in his mansion and become his servants. On May 31st, 2014, Morgan and Anissa lured their friend Peyton to the forest and proceeded to stab Peyton 19 times before abandoning her. Peyton managed to get help and survived the attack, leading to Morgan and Anissa's arrest. In July of 2016, it was decided that Morgan and Anissa would be trialed as adults. Number 4. Dana Sue Gray. Born on December 8, 1954, Dana Sue Gray was a nurse who in 1994 had recently been fired from work and had a terrible shopping addiction. Being unable to pay her massive debts, Dana found a bloodier way to buy what she wanted. Dana did not have a stable life. She had seen her mother die of breast cancer. She consumed drugs, was kicked out of her house when she was a teen, and forced to terminate two pregnancies against her will. After being recently divorced, Dana decided to get money the easy way and began to murder elderly women from the Canyon Lake community in order to appropriate and use their credit cards. In the span of a month, from February to March, Dana killed Norma Davis, June Roberts, and Dora Beebe. Dana also attempted to kill Dorinda Hawkins, but failed. Dorinda provided the evidence the police needed to apprehend Dana. The police discovered that after Dana killed each victim, she went on a shopping spree, and according to Dana herself, she was unable to control this overwhelming urge, which led her to commit the crimes. Number 3. Tan Teck Soon. For many people, a breakup can be heartbreaking. But for Malaysian man Tan Teck Soon, the idea that his girlfriend Chong Kar Yin might break up with him because of a pair of chopsticks was enough to kill her and then attempt suicide. Tan and Chong had been dating for over a month, and they were quite happy. But on March 7th, 2009, everything turned forever for the worst. That day, Tan and Chong had gone to a restaurant to eat. When Tan refused to get some chopsticks, Chong got angry, and though they soon made amends, things did not last for long. Tan saw that Chong spent most of their meal texting, making Tan extremely nervous. After Tan took Chong to her apartment, another quarrel happened when they arrived to the 12th floor where Chong resided. Tan thought Chong would break up with him, so he pushed her off the building and then jumped behind her, hoping to die by her side. In an ironic twist, Tan survived, which meant that the end of the relationship was over by his own hand. Number 2. Richard Lawrence. Born in the 1800s, Richard Lawrence was a house painter who went mad and attempted to assassinate President Andrew Jackson. Richard Lawrence had immigrated to the United States at an age of 12 and had a seemingly normal childhood. Lawrence found a job as a house painter and had a very normal life until 1832, when his behavior drastically changed. Lawrence quit his job and claimed that the United States owed him money, as he was actually Richard III of England and he owned the states. Lawrence became convinced that President Andrew Jackson was blocking the payments he was owed, and Lawrence thought that if he killed Jackson, the next president would pay what Lawrence believed was owed to him. Lawrence attempted to assassinate Jackson during the funeral of Congressman Warren R. Davis. Lawrence attacked Jackson with two pistols, but both weapons failed to work, and Lawrence soon found himself being saved from the brutal beating that Jackson quickly unleashed on Lawrence. Number 1. Issei Sagawa. Born on April 26, 1949 in Kobe, Japan, Issei Sagawa was anything but a normal man. On June 11, 1981, he successfully killed and cannibalized Renee Hartvelt. According to Sagawa himself, he suffered from cannibalistic fetishes and fantasies since a young age and had a great desire to consume human flesh, especially that of a woman. At the age of 23 in Tokyo, Sagawa attempted his first attack on a German woman. Though the woman fought back, he was charged with attempted rape. Years later, Sagawa immigrated to France in an attempt to get a PhD in literature at the Sorbonne University in Paris. It was there where Sagawa continued his attempts to eat human flesh. After several failed attempts, Sagawa finally succeeded on June 11, 1981, when he killed Renee. Sagawa proceeded to sodomize and devour part of the corpse, and later dumped the remains in a lake where he was spotted and arrested by the police. Today, Sagawa is alive and free in his native Japan. After he was declared insane and extradited from France, Sagawa has been very open about his story, and his story was narrated in the book In the Fog.